It just went from being head knowledge, you might say, or even spiritual knowledge, to fodder for prayer.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today.
Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
I thought you were pretending you were Lurch at first.
You rang.
Yeah, and I'm sorry about your cold.
That's okay. It's just a little cold. I can sing bass this morning. You know that?
Okay.
You know the old Jungle Book movie with the cartoon version?
Oh yeah.
Where the buzzards?
Doo, 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 doo. Yeah.
The buzzards are singing. That's What Friends Are For, in like barbershop quartet style. And then the tiger comes in at the end. I can actually hit that note when I'm like this. So I'll be like, "That's what friends are for."
Yeah. Good job.
I can actually hit that note, man. That's amazing. I can't do that most days.
I was thinking of that song that says, "Papa sang bass, Mama
Yeah.
sang tenor."
I
I don't
can't
remember
do the
what the
tenor
rest of the
notes right
song
now.
is.
Whew. Anyway.
Okay, so here we are, a sunny Tuesday morning, and it's still spring, although it feels like summer right now. But as much as the seasons change and our bodies change, we know that God doesn't change. So let's pray. Father, thank you that we can always draw near to our rock, our fortress, one who doesn't change. You're the same yesterday, today, and forever, regardless of our filters and our bodies and all that we're going through. And thank you that you're the same. Thank you that you are love. Thank you that you're near to us when we call. So wash us afresh this morning in the blood of Jesus. Wash us with the washing of your word. Cleanse us, fill us with your good spirit, and help us to have ears to hear what you're saying to us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So I had a long driving weekend. My cousin's daughter was being married about 256 miles away. I think that's what my maps said. And I left Saturday morning after taking care of the grandkids and getting breakfast for everybody and walking the pups. And I jumped in the car and I drove about 4.5 hours. And I got there in time to take a nap at the hotel. And then I got to attend the lovely wedding and see my cousins and see relatives I hadn't seen for a while. My brother and his wife were there. So it was like a family reunion as well as a wedding celebration. But in the process, I had lots of time. And on the way down, I listened to most of the Book of Judges, big chunks of the Psalms, and it was edifying. But I also had opportunities to apply my, and I don't have a good name for it, but my spiritual disciplines of seeking God according to all these principles that he's been laying out for us. So a couple of years ago, we started going through these principles of coming to his presence. So we make a joyful shout, we sing, come into his presence with singing, we give thanks, and we praise his name. And I've been ordering my way this way. As it says in Psalm 50, he that orders his way aright, I will show the salvation of God. So I've been ordering my way this way into my sixth year now. And then, as you remember, a couple of years after that began, God led us into the tabernacle, which all of a sudden I saw the parallels. You come into his courts with praise, you enter his gates with thanksgiving. So this is the gates in the court of the tabernacle. And then the first thing you do is you see the altar, which immediately you think of Jesus dying for our sins. Then you see this basin, brass basin, which is where the priests had to wash their feet. And then you go into the first chamber, and on the left, you see the golden lampstand, which represents the church. And the job was to fill these little lamps with oil, which represents the Spirit. So as I was going through these disciplines, the neat thing was I didn't have the opportunity to have my laptop in front of me or to read anything that had been printed out because I'm driving. So it was all from memory. It was all from having done this for, boy, over a year now. And scriptures kept coming to my mind. But it's the first one that came to my mind was 1 John 5, verses 5 through 8. Jesus is the Son of God. This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not with the water only, but with the water and with the blood. And the Spirit is the one who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. There are three that testify, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree. Now that was just awesome to me, because I saw the altar and the basin and the golden lampstand as the blood and the water and the Spirit. And then two other verses came to mind. 2 Corinthians 13:14. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. There's the three. This is the Trinity. Now, you probably know that there's not really one magnificent Trinity verse in the Bible. But if you read the Bible enough, you'll see the Trinity. And there's one of the better explanations, or I'm not sure explanation is the right word, but one verse that captures Jesus, God, and the Spirit, the three. But there's another verse at the end of 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23. May the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I thought, it's not as clear as 2 Corinthians 13, but I thought, there it is again. We've got a spirit, we've got a soul, we've got a body. And I'd been thinking about how we're supposed to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, strength. So there's these different components, but I hadn't put them together with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit. Okay, so back to my driving before I go off on a tangent here. So as I'm driving, I'm wanting to do my spiritual discipline. I'm wanting to come into his presence with singing, etc. And so I started by making a joyful shout. I followed it up by singing hymns, which I've memorized several. And I then went through giving thanks and praising his name. And then I went to these next three, the blood, the water, and the Spirit. So I'm telling you this because we're in the middle of our study on the Holy Spirit. And it just went from being head knowledge, you might say, or even spiritual knowledge, to fodder for prayer. Now, that might be the title of this podcast. I'm not sure. But because I have read these passages so many times, over and over in these disciplines, I have 17 studies, which I read through, and I just keep cycling through them. But as I do, these words are not just words. They're not just, I can put it this way, they're not just liturgy. They're not just readings. This is the inspired word of God. And the more that I read them, they're getting inside of me. I don't know how to describe it, but I'm getting inside of them, and they're becoming a part of my prayer life, because this is how I think we need to be praying, is according to his will, which means according to truth, which means through scripture. So I'm just going to touch on a couple passages that were quickened to me as I was praying, and I'm going to do it in the order that God revealed them to me. Because it was the Spirit, which we've been studying now for 8 podcasts, I think, we've been talking about the Spirit. And so when I came to the Spirit, all of a sudden, I started not just praying, God, fill your church with your good Spirit, because the lampstand is the church, and fill her up so that her light shines. That's why they filled up these lamps, so that there was a light shining. And what was the light to be doing, and all these kind of things. Instead of just reading through these passages, I began to pray them. And see if I can explain this. I don't know how well a job I'm doing on this. So I pray for the church. And so immediately I thought of Ephesians 5. Paul says, be filled with the Spirit. And John chapter 4, true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. So I pray, God, fill us, because it's not just the church. I'm not praying for somebody else. I'm a part of the church. So I say, fill us with your Spirit. Help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. And then instead of just like doing one passage, then my mind, and it was, I know it was God working, I thought, and help us to die to ourselves. Help us to learn to say yes to Jesus and no to ourselves. Help us to take up our cross. But we just, our last podcast was, by the power of the eternal Spirit, Christ offered himself to God as a perfect sacrifice for our sins. So Holy Spirit, help us to die to ourselves. Help us to live to you. And then I can continue on this vein, and you pray for the church. And the Holy Spirit has made you overseers to care for the church of God. This is Acts 20:28. So, Father, fill your leaders with your Spirit. Because as I was driving back, I decided to do back roads instead of just Interstate 95, which is just, it's Interstate 95. It's all you need to say. It's awful. And it's tense. So I did back roads, and I'm passing all of these churches. And this is Sunday morning when I'm returning home. And so I start praying for these churches. And bless us, Spirit of God, because you're the one that made us overseers. And then I thought of Romans 5:5. The love of God has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. So I pray, Father, help us to take in your love. Spirit of God, be poured into our hearts so we can take in your love in a new way. But the reason is because John 13 says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. So this is the reason why we need to love each other, not just so we can love each other, which is good in and of itself, but so that we can be an example. We can be a light. Oh, light. That's tied in with the golden lampstand too. And Matthew 5:16 says, you are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on the lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Who's in the house? Now my mind goes back to the tabernacle. This is the 12 tribes are in the house. These people are watching to see if there's someone that really lives out the gospel and really loves one another. And then, I'm sorry, I read verses 14 and 15 first. Here's verse 16. Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So the Spirit is given to us so that we can love each other. And as we love each other, we can be a light. But I also know that I can't love one another until I've first been loved by God. And that's the Spirit of God that helps me to love and receive his love so then I can give it out. So it was these verses on the Spirit that just started pouring through me as I was praying. And I went, oh, this is why I'm studying the scripture so much, so that, boy, I it's a part of me now, and I can pray it and I can apply it. So let me go back to the first one, the blood, the altar. Exodus 29 says, and this is review for those of you that have been listening. This is what you shall offer on the altar. 2 1-year-old lambs each day continually, the one lamb you shall offer in the morning and the other lamb you shall offer at twilight. Okay. And then Hebrews chapter 10, our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all time, for by that one offering he forever made perfect those who are being made holy. Hebrews 13, 12, Jesus suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood. Hebrews 10, 10, God's will for us was to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. And as I have read these scriptures over and over, now I'm able to pray for the church. Thank you, Father, for that single sacrifice for sins that makes us perfect. Thank you that you have sanctified us through your blood. Thank you that you've made us holy by the sacrifice of your Son. Thank you that you've freed us from our sins by shedding your blood for us, Revelation 1:5. Instead of just saying, okay, the altar, God, cleanse us by your blood. No, these passages are just part of me now, and it just starts pouring out. And then the water. Exodus chapter 30, where we first learn about this. You shall also make a basin of bronze with its stand of bronze for washing. You shall put it between the tent of meeting and the altar, and you shall put water in it, with which Aaron and his sons shall wash their hands and their feet when they go into the tent of meeting or when they come near the altar to minister. And then I think John 17, 17, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. John 15, 3, you're clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Ephesians 5, 25 to 27, Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her that he might sanctify her, having cleansed her by the washing of water with the word. And then Titus chapter 3, when the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of works done by us in righteousness, but according to his own mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewal of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior. So I had an awesome time in the car, and I had no time limitations. I had a 4.5-hour drive. So I prayed and I sang and I believed, and I was trying to take notes, but I couldn't because I was driving. So I was making little acronyms in my head so that I could remember things when I got to a red light or something and I could write stuff down. But it was just a rich time with God. But it was a result of all these over and over reading through these passages and then applying them for the church. And then, of course, I went through and I bound the strong man and I blessed the church and I blessed God himself. And it was awesome. And I was not suspecting it. And one of the things that happened was when I was driving home on 95, I realized traffic was getting tougher and tougher as I got close to Washington, D.C. And I thought, this is not going to be a profitable trip if I am just white-knuckle driving all the way through these cities. Even though it was a Sunday, it's like everybody's going home from their vacations or something, and there was a lot of traffic. And I was praying. I said, Lord, should I get off and go the back way? Because it's going to add 45 minutes to an hour. Mileage was similar, but it just takes more time going through these little towns. But boy, Virginia was beautiful, and coming through Maryland and this roundabout route, the sun was shining, it was spring, the leaves were coming out, the trees were in full blossom, and it was just a rich experience that I wouldn't have had if I was white-knuckling it through Washington, D.C. and Baltimore. So there you go. That was my weekend, but I felt like it was a compilation of reading the scripture and then just the Holy Spirit, who we've been studying, showing me how to apply what I've been learning in my mind and in my heart, but then applying it through my prayers. There you go.
Rock on, man. That's very cool.
It was cool. See, this is what I'm really convinced. This is what God designed us to be. God designed us to be worshiping warriors. He designed us to be priests. And nobody can stop me. I shouldn't put it that way. But you know what I'm saying?
Sure.
I mean, because these things are in my heart, and they could be making laws that you can't quote scripture and you can't pray and all this and that. But nah, it's inside. It's part of me now. And so if I was sitting in a cell, I'd be able to sing hymns. I'd be able to believe. I'd be able to apply these scriptures and continue to do my job. This is my job. This is the work of God that you believe, the Bible says.
You're doing the will of God, as it says in 1 Thessalonians, what is this, chapter 5, verses 16 through 18. Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances.
Amen.
For this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. It's just pouring out of you now, and like, I'm a witness to that, man. You're doing it. I don't do that on car trips very well. I'll pray for a little bit, and then I'm white knuckling it or listening to music or something. But maybe I'll get there.
No. Let me explain. I thought about this. I thought one reason I never did this in the past was I had 4 kids.
Yeah.
You know, my wife is there and we're trying to manage the kids and keep everybody happy. And we're wondering where we're going to eat our next meal and all this. I know this is unrealistic for many people, but sometimes I even do what I call the shortcut, the short form. I sing the doxology and I say the Lord's Prayer.
Yep.
Because the doxology incorporates coming into his presence with singing. You're giving thanks, you're praising his name. But then the Lord's Prayer, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. So we're praising his name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. You know, deliver us from evil. So we're binding the strong man and we're worshiping God. And I call that my Cliff Notes version. And this is the kind of thing. And I did forget during the wedding. Usually, even if I'm in an event or if I'm at a conference, I usually try to sneak away at least for a couple minutes and do my Cliff Notes version. But the more I've got stored up and becoming a part of my being, it's just easier to do. And I'm older and I don't have children climbing all over me and telling me that we need to stop and go wee-wees and I'm hungry and how much further and all that. So lots of grace for those of you that are in that camp. But I'm older now and I've got some time to myself. And this weekend, I'm going to be driving all the way to New England. So I'm going to have a lot more prayer time and worship time in the car, because now this is, I think it's 400 miles each way. So, and I can't find a good flight, and I don't know any people that have a plane that want to drive me or fly me up there, but I'm thinking of making some calls.
Nice.
Okay, well, let's pray. Father, thank you that we're not just sitting here reading scriptures and talking about things that, while profitable and spiritual and inspired, that's not the end. Thank you that all these things that we've been learning, we've been storing up, just like these vessels of oil, just like these virgins in Matthew 25, that they were storing up the golden oil. And I pray that you help us to continue to store up your oil and to not only read your word, but let your word dwell in us richly, as it says in the Bible. Let it become a part of our very being, so that it just pours forth in ways that we don't even understand. Thank you for being with me, coming home and driving down and back. And thank you for what you taught me today. And I thank you for your word that's profitable, living, active, and it's just awesome. And I worship you because you are the one who's awesome and you are the one that's worthy of our worship, in Jesus' name. Let everybody listening today get a fresh draft of living water, living faith, living encouragement, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email Steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.